Welcome back to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I'm not Chat Show. No, I'm Sam Levine. I don't know where Chat Show is today. He called in sickly. I'm very excited to be sitting here, though, because boy, do we have a good one for you today. I'm not going to waste anyone's time with boring information about my life, although I do want to check in quickly with Jamie Foxx, if she's around. Hey, Jamie.
Hi.
How you doing?
Did you do that on purpose?
Nope.
I was in the middle of makeup.
I didn't do it on purpose.
No.
I didn't. Out of the corner of my eye, otherwise I would have just shot over to you without any warning.
I think it was pretty seamless, though. I think I just like turned and was like, hello.
It was pretty perfect. I mean, we don't have a monitor here or anything, but I have to imagine that looked great.
No, I'm doing very well. I'm excited to start the show.
I'm excited to start the show as well. Our guest today, this is not her first time on our show. No. She is a veteran of this here chat show, but she has a very exciting new book that we are dying to hear about. So I'm not gonna waste any time. Just if the back of the book jacket, she has starred in films including, not only, but including Goodfellas, Cape Fear, To Die For, Picture Perfect, Ghost World, as well as TV shows 6 Feet Under, and of course, Easy to Assemble, the web series she created, starred in, which has been seen by millions of people. Ladies and gentlemen of the internet, please welcome Illeana Douglas.
Thank you.
Oh, no, thank you.
It's great to be here. First of all, Kevin, was it something I said?
I don't know what's going on between the two of you guys. I hope you're working out.
We've co-starred in so many films and web series together, too.
We're trying to calculate the number. Did we have a ballpark?
It's probably like 17.
Oh,
I believe he's number one, and Mr. Tom Arnold is number two.
You know what? That's good company for both of them.
Yeah.
Let's be honest. He has
been in many of the films that I have been in, mm-hmm. that are included.
Right.
You can only, when you write a book, they make
you pick.
You know, you can only pick a couple, and Goodfellas always comes first to everyone.
Yeah. You know. Still can't believe it didn't win Best Picture.
Yes, I know.
Dances with Wolves, right? Yeah.
90?
Dances with Wolves.
Yeah. That movie came out in 90.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Also, like, Miller's Crossing came out that year, too, I believe, and it kind of got overlooked because people were like, it's Goodfellas, it's too similar. Mm. I'm like, no.
Well.
But well-remembered.
Absolutely.
On the AFI Top 100 list.
I think more so than Dances with Wolves.
I think so.
Yeah.
I mean, kudos to Mr. Kevin Costner. But,
No, not taking anything away from him. It's still a magnificent film. I'm just saying we're still talking about Goodfellas pretty prominently some 26 years later.
We are.
That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
As all the characters in it. It had a life of its own. And I write about it again in one of the chapters.
Ooh.
About the films and what it was like to be on the set and all of that. Yeah,
so this book, this is, now I don't want to call it a memoir.
Well, it's a memoir that's told through movies.
Oh.
And if you like, I can do a little bit even of the, I don't even have to explain it. I can just read a little bit of the introduction,
a paragraph, and it sets
up the entire book for people who haven't read it and would want to read it. They'll understand why it's fun and what my perspective is.
I love it, and our audio only listeners are very excited right now.
Fantastic.
They're about to have you read to them, so please.
Mike Nichols had just screened his masterpiece, The Graduate, in New York. Afterward, I was standing in line next to Glenn Gordon Caron, who had directed me in the film Picture Perfect. We were waiting to meet Mr. Nichols. I was holding one of his legendary comedy albums that he had recorded with Elaine May, hoping to get him to sign it. Glenn whispered to me, "Huh, boy, only you could get away with that." I held out my album to Mr. Nichols, and he pointed at me and said, You know what I like about you? You managed to be both in the movie and outside it, commenting to us in the audience. And then he signed my album with admiration, Mike Nichols. Among the pantheon of movie gods I've traveled in, Mike Nichols was Zeus. I was getting the nod from Zeus. Mike Nichols was not just insightfully describing my on-screen persona, he was also describing my life, which is often played like a movie, with me both in the movie and outside it, commenting to the audience. Well, I remember how it began, but I have no idea how it's going to end. And I pass this on not to impress you about me, but to impress you about Mike Nichols, because his words and the advice he was about to give me had a profound influence on me.
Wow.
And so this led to me writing the book. And that became the through line of years of people saying, you have so many great stories, you're so funny, when are you gonna write a book? But I said, well, what's the through line?
Okay.
And so when I met Mike Nichols, and he said, you have this quality, you're in the movie and you're outside the movie, I was like, that's my life, that's been my whole life. So I wanted it to be a memoir, not, and then this happened, and then this happened, yeah. But that each chapter was a story devoted to either a film I was in, mm-hmm. or someone who had a profound influence on me, like, you know, Marlon Brando, mm-hmm. or Robert De Niro, or Roddy McDowall, or Rudy Valley, or, you know, the film work I did with Allison Anders, and what it was like to work with a female filmmaker of the day. And so each, I think that what's fun about the, first of all, it's a very fast read. That's what everybody writes me. But each chapter is a story with a beginning, middle, and end.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And it's the idea that I feel that everybody's life is a movie, mm-hmm. and it triggers people's own reflections of their own movie-going experiences. And if you think of your life as a movie, it's remarkable how it'll start to make sense, or not make sense at all. And if it doesn't make sense at all, you can say, well, this is the middle part of the movie.
Right, this
it
is...
It doesn't make any sense.
We're in Act Two. we gotta get some closure here before
yes.
we can get to Act Three. Well, that's wonderful. And also, you were like, well, Kevin wrote a book. How hard can it be?
That's true.
Come on.
That's true. Kevin was writing his book during one of our many, many films that we've done together.
Yeah. I guess I'll have to eventually write one. No, that's not gonna happen. I'm now very greedy because you read that passage and you sucked me in so well.
Oh, thank you.
Do you have any other passages?
Well, I have so many. I mean, we can keep I'm gonna set up very briefly that it's called I Blame Dennis Hopper.
Yes.
Because my parents were very much movie going, you know, they used to love to go to the movies, they dated through going to the films, and in New York and Greenwich Village, and went to see all the old movies, etc. My grandfather, who I talk about quite extensively, Melvin Douglas, two-time Academy Award winner, you know, so they had that framework of films. But they had just moved to Connecticut to kind of, you know, pursue the middle class Connecticut all-American dream.
Sure.
And then they went to see that darn movie, Easy Rider, which expressed these kind of anti-establishment, the rise of the hippie culture, drug use,
yep.
communal living, freedom, which again, freedom in those days, freedom now means like freedom to carry my gun and, you know, now, but freedom then meant freedom from the establishment,
right.
freedom from the shackles of a 9-to-5 job,
right.
which is what my father had, you know. And so he left his job and he started a commune called The Studio, and
based just on seeing the movie Easy Rider?
Yes, that, and apparently the Beatles song Nowhere Man also had had some slight influence
okay.
too, as I hear it. But it was, you know, it was Dennis Hopper and the values of the film, and his Dennis Hopper's rebellious nature about freedom mm-hmm. in the film. And Dennis Hopper himself was an iconic, interesting personality because he rose in the studio system. With small supporting movies and many films like Giant, Rebel Without a Cause. Then he left the studio system, did Easy Rider with Peter Fonda, and became a huge counterculture hit. And then he kind of dropped out of society too. He kind of stumbled after all the great success of Easy Rider. Yeah. And I write about the communal living too, is it starts to become a bit of a problem with you know, it's in the beginning, it's all fun. Everyone's making pottery and wearing ponchos and smoking pot. But at the, but what you find out pretty quickly is that, you know, free love is expensive, and somebody had to support this endeavor.
Right.
And we became poor pretty quickly. Huh. So the reason I always blame Dennis Hopper is that what I felt was going to be my movie, which was upper class kid going to Ivy League schools, that was ripped away from me. And instead it was, you know, food stamps and hippies and motorcycle people and people dropping acid on the front lawn and, you know, getting, you know, made fun of by everyone around me. And but what I talk about is, like, I finally come around to realizing that in many ways I ended up with the better life after all. And what's interesting is, I'll read this little part right here. It was inevitable that the impact that Dennis Hopper had on making my life like a movie, I would return the favor by being in a movie with Dennis Hopper. It was called Search and Destroy. How appropriate. And once he was cast, Dennis Hopper playing my father figure lover, I couldn't wait to meet him, tell him how he'd ruined my life, and ask for all the money I believed he owed me. The movie was set in New York, and on the way to the set of this very low-budget film, the overworked, underpaid production assistant who was driving me in the production van fainted, just as I had at Saks, and smashed into the back of another car, causing a three-car pileup on Park Avenue South. If you're counting, this was my second van accident, thanks to Dennis Hopper. I hadn't been in the van long enough to even put on my seatbelt. My head slammed into the dashboard. That woke the assistant up. And it turned out the production hadn't provided us with walkie-talkies. So, head throbbing, I staggered down Park Avenue to the armory where we were shooting while the assistant stayed with the police. By the time I arrived on set, I was dizzy, so I lay down on the marble floor of the lobby with my eyes closed. I explained to the first assistant director and the producer that we'd been in a car accident. And the producer asked me, will you be able to work today? And I said, I don't know, my head really hurts, it's really bad. Then I closed my eyes to try to stop the spinning. I felt like I was going to sleep, and then one voice cut through the static in my brain. The voice said, are you okay? And I recognized the voice. It was my father. How did my father get here? Oh God, I thought, I'm dying, and my Dennis Hopper-like life is flashing before my eyes. And then I realized, wait a minute, that is Dennis Hopper. That's the real Dennis Hopper. Dennis Hopper, the iconic figure from Easy Rider, who had changed my life and now caused this poor bastard production assistant to have a three-car pileup. I opened my eyes, but I could only make out his silhouette bathed in white light above me. Are you okay? He repeated. I said, I'm fine. I just can't look at the light. And then I started to cry, and I couldn't stop crying. And Dennis Hopper said, don't cry. Please don't cry, you're going to be okay. And I said, no, I'm crying because my father saw Easy Rider when I was a kid, and it changed my life. And now we're in a movie together, and it's a miracle. It's a miracle. And Dennis Hopper knelt beside me, and he put his hand on my shoulder and said, Illeana, you've had a concussion. You know what that means? It means your brain moved inside your head. It's not supposed to do that.
That's magnificent.
And it continues on from there, but that was the whole buildup of my entire childhood and all the stigma I felt growing up, being a hippie kid and not getting what the other kids had. And in this, and I write about how in that chapter it followed me even into success. Even into success, when I was successful in a premiere, I'd be like, there's free food. Do you see that there's free food? You know, that those kind of feelings never go away. Like the year I think I lived on popcorn in New York, you know, not being able to afford, you know, a gas. And we only had electricity, so we had a, girls and I had a percolator, and we'd cook hot dogs and hard-boiled eggs. After we, and they sort of taste a little like coffee, but it's okay. And you could put soup in there and pretty much clean it out and then make coffee again. And, you know, you live that way because you wanted to be an actor. And so all these things that I considered to be slights my whole life, suddenly with faced with meeting Dennis Hopper. Mm-hmm. I was like, I felt like we were all the, you know, he was cradling me in my arms and comforting me. And I thought, this is incredible. Like, I'm meeting the man who has changed my life and my destiny, and we're in a film together. And in many ways, we are all the children of Dennis Hopper, because we're all doing these independent films.
Oh, sure.
So in that moment, I forgave my parents, because as I said, I realized, maybe it could have been the bump on the head, but mm-hmm. I realized I ended up with not only with a better life, but with all the philosophies, the good philosophies of why they wanted to start that commune in the first place, and have the goats and the chickens and ride them around town, and all of the idea of the embarrassment and the horror, and it became like, thank God I had that childhood.
Yeah.
You know, thank God they arbitrarily pull me out of school and have art day, and you know.
Yeah.
Because that led to this kind of rebellious nature that I think has served me well the rest of my life.
Very much
and
so.
The rest of my career. So I honor Dennis Hopper by blaming him. And as I say at the end of the chapter, if there's anything you don't like about me, don't blame me, blame Dennis Hopper.
And I will. From here on out, I plan to blame Dennis Hopper.
Thank you.
My pleasure. I feel like I'm not going to be able to do a good enough job with this interview until I finish reading the book. So if you could just sit there quietly for the next 10 minutes or so, I would really appreciate it.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Well, we'll keep reading.
Yeah, I'll. I'm very excited myself to read this book now. I'm a very slow reader, though, so I'm going to need some time off from work and life.
Well, as I said, when I was a kid, I used to love short story books mm-hmm. because I would feel this pressure of I'd want to read the ending and see what happened.
Right.
And so I very much wanted to do a book that you could pick up any chapter, you know, like, oh, that seems like a funny title, and then just go right to that chapter and you'll have a story with a beginning, middle, and end.
Mm-hmm. I feel like you're not going to let me down on that front. I happen to get back to the acknowledgments.
Yes.
And if I may.
Sure.
Let's see. A deep bow and tip of the hat to those who have given me opportunities to learn. I'm just going to name a few of the people in this list.
Yes.
You already mentioned Alice Anders, Hal Ashby, Ingmar Bergman, Peter Bogdanovich, Brando, Albert Brooks, Robert De Niro, Brian De Palma, Richard Dreyfuss, Jeff Goldblum, Joseph Mankiewicz, Elaine May, Lee Marvin, Peter Sellers, Gary Shandling, John Patrick Shanley, Peggy Siegel, Sharon Stone, Jennifer Tilly, Gus Van Sant, and James Woods. So really, you've not been able to work with any of the greats.
Well,
and that's, I'm so sad for you, Illeana.
Well, I write about how most of the time, you know, I mean, I think of myself as I'm part film historian, part film evangelist. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm the biggest movie fan there is. And when I was a kid, because of the circumstances of the way I grew up, I became obsessed with movies. They really filled a void for me. In a sense, my parents, this is the way I describe it, they were in their own movie. They were in their kind of 1970s, you know, movie, counterculture hippie movie.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't fit in that movie, and I didn't want to be in that movie. Once I discovered my grandfather was Melvin Douglas and lived in a really nice apartment in Riverside Drive, and I could go to the set in a town car and be seated next to the director watching Peter Sellers, I was like, that's the movie I somehow need to get in that movie.
Yeah.
And so I spent my life I just wanted to be in show business. Although I, of course, wanted to be an actor because that's what my grandfather wanted for me, I started out acting, but my first professional jobs were working for film publicists. So I would assist directors and things like that, because I was always fascinated with film.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, again, this comes from being plucked from a circumstance where we were really poor and going to the movies was like a really big deal.
Sure.
And I had all the posters of people on, and I was particularly obsessed with Peter Sellers and the Pink Panther. And then I have my grandfather inviting me to the set of Being There, and now I'm sitting 10 feet away from Peter Sellers. and that's jarring, I mean, for a child. And also this idea that, you know, hundreds of people are making this film. And so, you know, I got to sit next to the director, who was Hal Ashby, and I was listening to him, you know, and he was directing Jack Warden and my grandfather and Peter Sellers. And so he would run to the set, direct them, then come back. And that's when I thought, wow, this is great, because there was a safety in sitting next to him that I felt comfortable doing that. Because anyone who wants to be an actor, some people have a certain fear of a braggadocia. I certainly had that. Mm-hmm. Like, on the one hand, you were like, I'm the greatest actor in the world, and everybody should know it, you know, versus, I'm horrible, oh. Let me just sit quietly and watch other people. Mm-hmm. And that's certainly what I had. And so by sitting in the shadows, watching my grandfather, that almost felt just as good, because I could share the accolades of Melvin Douglas, as his granddaughter. But sitting next to Hal Ashby and watching him talk to the technicians is where I think the seeds of the insider-outsider began to develop. Because throughout my career, all the time when I was an actor, because I knew so much about movies and movie making, mm-hmm. I would always end up not spending time with actors, but spending time with the director. Oh, what shot are you going to do? And there would always be this shock that I was interested.
Right.
What lens are you going to put on that? You know, they look at you like, well, you care, you know?
Yeah.
You know, and I'd say,
but you did care.
So this culminated really, you know, by the time that I did the film To Die For with Gus Van Sant, where essentially it's two films. I don't know if you remember the film, but there's a narrative film. And then within the narrative film, there's a documentary. And I'm being interviewed for the documentary. Well, we shot that first. And so without any kind of crew around, it was just a skeleton crew doing this documentary. And we were free form and doing improv and let's shoot it this way and let's ask her this question. And so I had all this inside information, and I had the director, which you never have in a movie, completely to myself. So Gus taught me so much about lenses and, you know, with this shot and that shot, and you know, we would talk, and he'd say, "What shot would you do?" And I'd say, "Well, I would do one of your overheads, Gus, because that's, I always like the way you do your overheads." And, you know, and he'd say, "That's a good idea. I think I'll do an overhead."
Yeah.
So I found that some of the best experiences I've had where I'm not only an actor, but I'm collaborating, and I always had this collaborative nature.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, as I said, I've hit a brick wall where people are like, why are you interfering? I don't really, we just want you to be the actor.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it was a natural sense of, hey, I'm a movie fan. I mean, imagine a movie fan being unleashed on a film and not having a good editing process, to not know enough, to not know, oh, you're not actually supposed to volunteer those ideas.
Sure, but even so, you get to a point, and I feel like it's one of those things where it happens early in your career because you're too naive, and then it happens much later in your career because you've been on set too many sets to just sit there and let it happen, where you say, no, the thing you're about to do is not going to work, and now I'm going to tell you why.
Yes.
And there's that Goldilocks zone where you're making your career, you're like, well, I'm going to let the director make his or her own mistakes. I'm not going to say anything. The DP will tell them. They'll figure it out. But then you do swing back around again, because I've certainly seen my fair share of older actors, as I'm sure you have, on set who the director's lining up a shot. He goes, no, I'm not going to let you shoot me from this way, because you shot her from that way, and it's not going to match.
Yes, but sometimes, as I said, I've been on a set, and I don't know why. I used to... But I think, as I said, when writing the book, I think it came from the being there. Is I'd be standing there, and somebody, you know, again, it was like a good friend, now Glenn Gordon Caron, you know, on the set of Picture Perfect, he'd be doing something, he'd go, what? What is it? Oh, what? You wouldn't do that? What? Oh, what, Marty can do 360s and I can't? Is that what? I was like, no, I'm just waiting. I'm just waiting for the makeup. I'm not even thinking anything.
Oh, I'm not judging you.
But, you know, but that would often happen. Like, I'd be on a set, and if something would go wrong, the director would pull me aside, and I'd go, what did I do? And they'd be like, we're not going to tell Marty about this, right? I'm going to pick up the phone and go, yeah, this guy is... He did not have a shot today.
We did not make our day.
Nothing went well at all.
Yeah, you should let me probably take the ship over tomorrow.
I mean, I think of myself as, like, again, imagine this movie fan who's like, oh, the bonus is I actually get to be in the movie.
That's the best bonus.
But, like, for me, getting to be, I mean, I was such a huge fan of Gus Van Sant. That's number one. But, so I meet Buck Henry. I'm like, this is genius. Because every day I'm going to ask him about The Graduate.
Sure.
And so the first day, you know, I meet him. Well, he couldn't have been more flattered. Oh, he's telling me stories. And then I'm like, oh, great. Day two, catch 22. I'm like, so Orson Welles, you know, and we're talking. By day three, he saw me in the lunchroom. He had his tray and he was like, Illeana, you can sit with me. We can have lunch. You cannot ask me any more questions about my movies. Is that a deal? And I'm like, yeah, you know. So then I have that horror, that shame of like, oh my God, what am I doing? Like, just be in the movie, Illeana. That's what you're. But I have always, again, felt like it is, they're there. It's my responsibility. Mm-hmm. And I felt this way when I was 15. And I still, you know, I love film so much, and I love film history so much that, and I bet there's people out there that say the same thing. Like, you know, when you see someone and you just think, I got to ask them about one moment that they did in a film and it meant so much to me.
Oh, sure.
And just to have, because once they're gone, and you know, a lot of the people that I write about that I was able to meet, John Frankenheimer, Joseph L. Mankiewicz, Lee Marvin,
Mike Nichols,
you know, they're not, Dennis Hopper, they're not here anymore. And so it's important for us to keep their stories alive. You know, that's why I wrote about, you know, this experience of meeting Rudy Valli at the end of his life and what a poignant experience that was for all of us to know. Essentially, that chapter is about being a trooper, you know? I mean, certainly comedians understand that. You get somewhere and you're tired and you unpack your little clown bag and you make people laugh and you put your little suitcase, put your red nose in the Milton Berle powder puff bag, and then you're on the road, you know? And there's something really poignant about that for me. And I don't think the audience has ever realized that, but working again, very briefly in this, you know, my first ever job working at this just terrible dinner theater in the boondocks, you know, was, and there is, of all people, is Rudy Valli, like in his 80s, still working.
Sure.
Still working. And just how that idea of him as if it were a Broadway opening night, you know, giving it his all every night. And so I just, again, that trajectory of the ghosts of what, you know, that that theater was, that building was, and Rudy Valli, and what Rudy Valli means in today's society. We've completely forgotten about him, and yet again, it's important to remember Rudy Valli because he invented a style of crooning that then Bing Crosby copied, and then Frank Sinatra copied Bing Crosby.
Right.
And, you know, and then you have Frank Sinatra, and then you, if you look at all the people today, the Harry Connick Jr.'s and the Michael Bublé's, they didn't just, you know, they didn't just start singing
own,
that
yeah.
way. There's a whole history of that,
and
that I feel is being, you know, forgotten about.
Wow. That's a wonderfully important point. I don't know if this is in the book, and I don't know if we talked about this last time you were here, and please forgive me if we did, but not surprisingly, you are in one of my favorite films of all time, Quiz Show.
Oh, thank you, yeah.
And that must have been quite a set to be on.
Well, again, it was interesting. That was a period I had auditioned. I had this very interesting run where, like, I was acting in movies and then I would get cut from them. So there's really, like, no proof that I was in the movie. Right. I think I'm sort of barely in it. I had auditioned for a major part in the film and I didn't get the part, and that's fine. But Mr. Redford, because he'd worked with my grandfather, Melvin Douglas, on The Candidate, and the reason he went into politics was because of my grandmother, Helen Gehagen Douglas, who lost her, she, you know, wanted to be in the Senate and went against, she coined the phrase Tricky Dick. Mm. Ran against Richard Nixon for a Senate seat in 1950 and lost, and he smeared her, and it destroyed her political career. And Robert Redford's father was profoundly affected by that. They were in California. They had voted for her. So everything he learned about politics as a kid, he learned originally from that campaign.
Wow.
And so because of that, he somehow wanted to fit me in the movie, which again sounds like a story from a, you know, I'm like,
absolutely.
I didn't necessarily want a smaller little part in the film, but when Robert, again, when Zeus says to you, yeah, I'd kind of like you to be in this movie. And I remember the day that we, I shot this thing, I spent more time in his trailer talking to him about my grandfather and the campaign and his, you know, kind of liberal views and mm-hmm. the film The Candidate. They kept coming to the door, knocking on the door and saying, you know, Mr. Redford, we really need to start shooting. And I actually spent more time in his trailer talking than I did on the set, yeah, shooting my scene. Mm-hmm. But I you know, it was an incredible experience. I've since seen him many times up at Sundance Film Festival.
Sure.
And so that was, you know, really exciting. The other thing I have to say about Quiz Show, please, is my obsession with John Turturro.
Oh.
Because there's actors you like, and then there's actors that we all have that you're like, I don't know, it's crazy. I'm obsessed with them.
Yeah.
And Turturro, James Woods is another one. Richard Dreyfuss, as many people know. But I discovered John Turturro at part of the New York theater scene, you know, when I was still in acting school. Mm-hmm. And then he did this John Patrick Shanley movie called Four Corners. And when I had just started working for Peggy Siegel, I saw an early screening of him. I was like, I don't know who this person is. Did they just get him off the street? Because he doesn't, I mean, he just seems like a construction worker that they put in this film.
Yeah.
And from that moment on, I just was, you know, so again, the experience of being with Robert Redford was great. I got to shoot my scenes with Ray Fiennes. That was very interesting. He just finished a little movie called Schindler's List, it hadn't come out yet.
Right, right.
So got to talk to him a little bit about that. But I was acting in one of the scenes. I had to watch John Turturro on screen. And John Turturro, so I watched him on screen. Mm-hmm. That's my only association with John Turturro. Then when I produced this film with Martin Scorsese that Dennis Hopper was in, I was like, we have to get, because again, the only reason I'm producing films mm-hmm. is to get people that I am obsessed with.
Right.
And put, like,
you just
Griffin
want to have
Dunn.
More Buck Henry lunches.
Yeah. So I got John Turturro in that movie. Then I actually got to do a scene with John Turturro. Then Grace of My Heart, we literally based like an entire character around John Turturro, so I could hit more hero mm-hmm. worship of John Turturro. And he got this award for Lincoln Center, and I remember that was my speech. Basically, my whole trajectory was, how could I get closer somehow to John Turturro? He's one of my and of course his work with the Coen brothers is out of control.
Yes.
I you know, what I want to do with the book is have it be successful, because there are so many people that we had to edit out, you know, stories. Mm-hmm. And again, people like Turturro, you know, I talk a little bit about him in Grace of My Heart, mm-hmm. the magnitude of what it felt for somebody like me to work with him. Just the experience, again, of You know, we talk about acting in terms of our own journey, but we never talk about acting so much of like, what does it mean as a milestone to work with someone who you're intimidated by?
Yeah.
You know, I was terribly intimidated by working with John or, you know, working with Robert De Niro. They're icons. Mm-hmm. And the ability, a lot of people have told me that they give this to acting students or people that are working with Robert De Niro. I've heard that a lot. I gave your book. You just got a movie with Robert De Niro, so I gave your book. So it's like breaking down. What does it feel like to how that's a challenge? You know, how do you take that person out of the equation so you can act with them? They're a real person. But they're also, you know, they're also an icon.
Absolutely. I just, whenever I find myself working with someone extremely famous, whether it be actor, actress, mm-hmm. director, I always just remind myself, when that person wakes up in the morning, the first two things they have to do are go to the bathroom and blow their nose, just like the rest of us.
That's your thing?
Exactly.
That's
I'm just funny. Like, I just imagine like Brad Pitt's morning activity. I was like, he has to get up and go to the bathroom. Everybody has to do it. He's a human being, just like all of us.
But so you talk and you try to treat them, even though 10 people have told you, don't look at him, don't acknowledge him. Yeah. I often wonder about that. Like when I had worked with Eddie Murphy, and Jay Moore and I have discussed this, mm-hmm. you know, we you know, I wouldn't have cared what the script, I was like, yeah, script, I'm fine. Eddie Murphy's in it. Mm-hmm. I mean, just to say, I get to work with Eddie Murphy. And Jay Moore and I, both coming off of action, you know, we got cast in this movie, which did not turn out to be the greatest film, Pluto Nash. But I remember, used it as a punchline many times and easy to assemble. We used to have Greg Proops, the great comedian.
Smartest man in the world, Greg Proops.
Played my agent on Easy to Assemble, and that was his running gag was, I'm the one who put her in Pluto Nash. Pluto Nash.
Come on,
it's
guys.
It's a great, great line. But when I was on set with Eddie Murphy, like, no one looked at him, no one talked to him, no one acknowledged him. And I had, of course, thoroughly been told, don't look at Eddie, don't talk to Eddie. But I think that what happens is sometimes does that become rote? And I figure, like, oh, what's the worst that can happen? I talk to Eddie, bites my head off.
Yeah.
But so I remember we were all standing on the set, like 20 people in complete silence. So I finally, like, I was like, hey, what'd you do last night? You know, he's like, nothing. I go, nothing. I was sat in my hotel room. I go, what? What do you mean you sat? Like, you didn't order a hamburger or anything? So, like, sometimes I feel like just, I don't know if it's my natural, just crazy infectiousness that mm-hmm. they don't get angry at me. But I end up like, I don't care. I'm not going to talk to them.
You know?
So, like, we ended up talking and kidding around. And I found that like, it lightened the set a little bit, too.
Sure.
But somehow, and I don't know why, maybe that, again, that's my crazy childhood, I always feel that's my responsibility. I don't I hate a quiet set. I like things to be lively and fun and infectious.
No,
and also to call my friends and go, I just talked to Eddie.
Well, no, from your own memories, that's the most fun place ever.
Yeah, it is.
Why should it be this boring library, you know, hospital where everybody has to be quiet? And
I just also think that, Illeana, you're really easy to talk to. Like, out of all the celebrities I met, like, I feel comfortable around you, and I actually consider you like a friend and a peer. Like, I don't, like, I think you just make people comfortable.
Oh, yeah,
absolutely.
I
100% agree.
I try to, until they, like Buck Henry, go, that's, or Lee Marvin. Please stop talking, young lady.
Well, Lee Marvin, I'm surprised you got through a full conversation with him talking about.
Well, that was astronomical. Again, people don't realize me, you know. But again, I'm a person who lives on magical signs, and you know, I'm, you know, very much again like a movie. If I'm, you know, looking for signs, like, is this the right path? Especially when you start out. And, you know, you don't have a lot of money and you have big aspirations to do something. And Lee Marvin was in one of the first movies I ever remember seeing, which was Paint Your Wagon.
Ah, and the ill-fated musical.
Yes.
Paint Your Wagon.
But again, seeing that as a child, to me, it was just like the music and it so he, you know, formed something. I got a huge crush on Lee Marvin. Made no sense.
No, but not at all.
Most of my childhood, I'd be like, oh, Dirty Dozen is on. You know, the war part, Jim Brown could care less. But like Lee Marvin, fixated on watching everything he did. And that carried through even to high school. So like, even when I was in high school, if Lee Marvin was in a movie like Cat Ballou or Pocket Money, or mm-hmm. I'd go to see it. A big film of his, for me, is which everyone should go see. It's The Big Red One. Sam Fuller, Mark Hamill is in it, and it's about World War II. Astonishing film. And I just happened to, the only reason I went to see it was because of Lee Marvin. But again, it's one of those interesting sensations you have as a kid, where you're like, "Wow, I'm feeling something," which is, for movie lovers, is always that interesting trajectory mm-hmm. of like, you're watching movies, you're going to see any movie, and then as you get older, you know, for me it was really a movie like Network, The Big Red One, you're like, I'm feeling emotions, this is affecting me.
Yeah.
Can movies do that, you know?
Absolutely, yeah.
And so being in school, I'd had a very rocky time at this first acting school I went to. They were just not convinced I had any talent at all, which I found astonishing. I was like, how could you not see this?
Come on.
You know, but so on my way to do, which I think is really overly dramatic, mm-hmm. in order to be asked back for the second year, they have something which was called your final scenes, which is already—
Oh, that's a terrible name.
Already not good. But I'm on my way to do my final scenes. And there, walking up Madison Avenue, and I'm going, please, God, show me a sign that I'm meant to be on the boards, like my grandfather. Yeah. I'm meant to be an actress.
Yes.
Win multiple Academy Awards, then do some Broadway.
Yeah.
There's Lee Marvin walking up Madison Avenue, and I'm just astonished of all the people. So, I got in his way.
Yeah.
Like, literally got in his way, and you know, the first movie I ever saw, you know, and I started to rattle off all of his movies and how much it meant to me, and then now I was an actor and I was going to do these scenes, and it was like, he just went, like, he just put his hand up.
I was about to say, if I could assume a Lee Marvin impression of how that went. Yeah, all right, thanks.
But even Lee Marvin, he said, well, young lady, if you have half as much energy on stage as you do in real life, you ought to do real well. And he walked on. And I was like, you know, these cliche, walking on air, I sailed through the my final scenes, and yet still was not asked back.
Oh! But, and have they ever remedied this?
Yeah, they use my name in advertising, but I refuse to say the name of the school.
Well, all right, that stuff burns me.
But I did get to meet the great Lee Marvin, and again, I it was a great, you know, lesson. So many times I write about where, and I think you can equate this in your life if you're a comedian, if you're mm-hmm. a musician, anyone in the arts, you often do meet the people that mean the most to you in somewhat surprising ways. And it's, you know, sometimes it's an embarrassment of riches, like to get to meet somebody like Lee Marvin, if that right moment that I was there and that I looked up and that I saw him and he happened to be in town, and just to get to see him in that way, somebody that meant so much for me, has always been the sign that these movie gods, in a sense, they literally came off the screen just when I needed them at the right time, and kind of imparted this wisdom, and then went back into the movies, you know, where they belong.
Mm. Are you have you seen the film Last Action Hero?
The Bruce Willis film?
The Schwarzenegger.
Yes,
Last Action Hero, where he's a movie star, and the kid sees him, and he has a magic ticket, and he gets to go into the movies.
Yes.
And all the tropes and the cliches.
Yeah.
I think that's an underrated film, with one of the greatest concepts of all time in cinema?
Well, I think that, I mean, I certainly, as a kid, I did that. I mean, that was something, you know, that I did.
We're stroking out. What's going on? Oh, we're losing light.
But yeah, that's something, you know, I wrote a lot about the drive-in experience, because again, so many of the films I saw when I was a kid I was in a drive-in, and you're sitting like kind of alone in a car watching a film. And for me, again, watching a movie like, you know, American Graffiti, I mean, that's where I developed my crazy obsession with Richard Dreyfuss, because he was like a big kid to me. So I just imagined that he was my friend.
And sure.
You know, and I didn't have any confidence, so I just took on all his cockiness in my own real life. And then it started working. Like, have you ever done that?
Oh, sure.
You're like, I'm just going to be Richard Dreyfuss in this whole situation.
100%.
And then it's, what was shocking is it worked.
I think I needed to pick a more confident character.
Yeah.
I went with Matthew Perry's Chandler Bing from Friends.
Oh, great.
Yeah, which you know, lovable, sure.
Yeah.
But not often the victor.
No.
No.
But it's interesting, but you see, but nobody knows that, and that's not a bad acting technique.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, some, you know, when people are painting, they copy other painters. So, you know, when you're an actor, why not copy other actors?
Absolutely.
I mean, I think eventually you need to develop your own style.
Yes.
And figure out what that is. Oftentimes, lately, I find actors are just being derivative of other actors.
Right.
Mainly James Dean. there's about 30 people that are just doing James Dean.
Well, Matthew Perry, to his credit, always said that he based a lot of Chandler's broader movements on Jackie Gleason.
Oh, interesting.
So really, I'm just doing Gleason, I guess.
Well,
that's
the whole, the chapter I wrote about Dreyfuss. It's called Me Doing Dreyfuss Doing Tracy, because when I finally got to work with Richard Dreyfuss and confessed to him that I was imitating him, he confessed to me that he was just being Spencer Tracy. And I said, wait a minute, I'm not even doing you. I'm doing you doing Tracy.
Right.
So that's fascinating.
That's the host of this show, Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I don't believe anyone since the late 80s has actually done a real Shatner or Walken impression.
Yes.
Everyone does impressions of Kevin's impression.
That's true.
Because
he isolates, you know, that one that one mannerism.
Yep. You find that one note. Once you can unlock that one note,
amazing.
The rest of it can flow. But unless you get that, you got nothing.
Yeah. I often wonder when people are so, somebody like Christopher Walken, then do you fall into, is that it becomes a challenge once people pick up on these, you know, characteristics, and especially when it becomes funny, you know, like Bette Davis or Christopher Walken, is it a challenge for them then to find out, I'm like, do I do that? Do I, you know, do I have all those? Do they start, because you do see with people, they start becoming a series of, you know, facial mannerisms and cliches.
Well, Walken has become his own impression at this point. I'm not even sure what to make of it.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the most iconic leaning into the punch I've maybe ever seen. But I don't want to get too off topic. I do want to talk more about the book.
Yes.
I've so enjoyed the two passages you've read so far.
Thank you.
I don't suppose you would be able to treat us to another passage.
Sure. Let me find another one. This is a fun little one. Let me see. Oh, this is the one I'm going to read, just a very small part of. There's an entire chapter devoted to. What's happening? What's going on here? There was an entire chapter devoted to the meeting of Marlon Brando, and I'm not going to do it. You got to read the whole chapter because it's got a whole great beginning and middle and end. But my whole life I'd carried these journals, and I had lost one, and I was going to have Marlon Brando sign my journal, and unfortunately I had lost it. So it was a big deal to get to meet Marlon Brando, and I was upset because I wasn't going to get his autograph. So that was the emotional baggage I was carrying when I met Marlon Brando the next day. I put on a lumpy brown sweater over a thrift store plaid schoolgirl skirt, thick woolen tights, and Doc Martens. It was too late to change. And even though he was always supportive, Marty took one look at me and said, "Is that what you're going to wear to meet Marlon Brando?" There was a knock at the door. Marty and I exchanged nervous glances. He repeated his mantra, "You'll be fine. Be yourself." I nodded, "Right." Right now, myself was busy feeling sorry for myself, so I knew I couldn't be myself. I would have to act something. I had once heard Orson Welles say, "We no longer place a value on listening." So I thought, that's what I will act. I will listen with great intensity. I will be Marty's wonderfully listening girlfriend. I will be still and quiet and respectful. Oh my God, the door is opening. Why am I wearing this ugly brown sweater? And there he was, Marlon Brando. And everything I was going to act went completely out the window. First of all, his presence, both physical and spiritual, was enormous. His eyes were a deep sapphire blue, a color I had never seen before, which was arresting enough. But astonishingly, they matched exactly the color of the blue velour sweatsuit that he was wearing. I thought Marlon Brando was wearing a blue velour sweatsuit. Who made that for him? Who owns that much velour? Does Marlon Brando know he's going to have to go through the door sideways? He said very quietly to Marty, "How do I look?" Marty said, "You look fantastic, Marlon." He was always a better actor than I. "Thanks," he said, "I lost 30 pounds. Jesus, I thought, from what, 300? "I'm a little embarrassed by my weight," he said. "Do you mind if we order lunch up here, away from prying eyes? Would that be okay?" We'd clearly been ready to walk out the door, but without missing a beat, Marty immediately agreed that yes, of course, we would order room service and have lunch in the room. And that would be much better, much more intimate. Marty gave me a slightly panicked look. I knew to discreetly call to cancel our reservation. I left the room, and when I returned, Marlon Brando had made himself comfortable on the couch. What I mean by that was that he had taken all of the cushions off the couch and tossed them on the floor. Then he took one square seat cushion,
Jesus,
propped it sideways so that it was like a pillow and he was lying against it. Huh. There was nowhere to sit. He was basically sitting on the entire couch. Opposite the couch were two provincial chairs. I took the farther one to the left so I wouldn't have to make eye contact with him, because I was pretty sure that if I did, I would burst out laughing or crying or ask him about acting or be a phony or any of the other things that Marty had warned me not to do. And it goes on from there.
Blue velour,
yes,
sweatsuit. Maybe my favorite part of the entire book. Only because, as great as the book is, and I thoroughly enjoyed it, visual of a 400-pound blue velour sweatsuit seems like it belongs in the Macy's Day Parade. Am I wrong?
No.
Attached to ropes.
It was, as my friend Jackie B used to say, there's fat and there's circus fat. It was circus fat. And yet, underneath that,
with
he's Marlon Brando.
Well, that was always the thing. When someone like that, who's not only brilliant and considered one of the greatest actors to ever walk Earth, stunningly handsome in his, at the apex, whatever year you want to choose that to be,
yeah,
to then decide, I'm not just going to eat whatever I want. I'm going for some sort of record.
Yeah.
I'm looking to be mocked. Orson Welles gave it a hell of a run. To blow up like a poison dog. I'm really gonna,
yes,
see where this can go.
Well, because he was not short. And
no.
I think that when people are heavy and they're tall,
yeah,
it's like, wow.
It becomes a Coke machine in tennis shoes.
That's what I said. I was like, does he know he's not going to fit through this door? Like, those are all the things I think of.
Yeah.
I'm like, this is not gonna be... It's not going to go. And then, as I said, when I came back in the room, I was like, he's on the entire couch.
There's no couch.
Yeah.
There's
he's
no
sitting
more couch.
On, like, he uses the cushion as like a pot, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
and yet in there, buried, is...
Well, that's what I talk about, though. Once he hit me with the eyes, it was like I was hypnotized.
That's it.
Yeah, it's the eyes. I knew it. That's why I didn't want to look. That's why I didn't want to meet
him. Don't look.
I didn't want to meet him. I couldn't handle it, but I was like, all right, now I'm meeting him. So as long as I'm meeting him, just don't look at him.
Whatever you do.
Yeah, and then of course, when you don't realize, you're instantly a distraction.
Yeah.
Because I'm sitting there going like...
looking every possible direction.
Like making sideways, you know, Chris Marty's like, what are you doing?
What are you doing?
Is your partner up? Why are you acting? And then Marty kept trying to bring me in the conversation, of course.
Yeah.
And I would do a lot of those, mm-hmm. and I'd be like, why? I had my whole act. I was going to be the listening, thoughtful.
Yeah. She really was listening, would be the takeaway for Marlon.
Well, I had that. I wanted, you know, like a European Italian actress, like at a press conference.
Right.
My director speaks for me. I don't need to speak. And then, of course, that all went out the window.
We need to talk about the period in your life where you dressed up like Elton John.
Oh. There, again, another photo that did not make the book.
Yeah, because this delights me to no end. Well, because first of all, there were seven different looks you could have gone.
No, I was the Tommy.
Great.
The Todd.
Sure. That was the look you took? Well, you know that. Yeah, sure.
My grandmother's. You know, as a kid, when you're trying these outfits, they don't exactly in your mind.
What year do we think that was?
Well, when did Tommy come out?
70.
Because I was going to say, I saw the tour like in 74.
Well, this was the movie, Tommy.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
But I saw Elton's tour shortly after that, around 74, when he had giant glasses and the...
Well, the first album that I ever, and I can't say bought, I stole, because I was a total...
Because you read Abbie Hoffman Steal This Book?
No, because we were poor, and I didn't... I had to keep up like other people.
Sure, absolutely.
So there was this store.
And that would have been your conversation with the judge, should you have had to appear in front of him or her.
Thank God I got away with it. I know when I get to heaven, it's going to be like, okay, we have all the albums that you stole.
Your Honor, I was poor. I did not see an option. I needed to stick.
Well, I was one of those poor kids, which is even worse. I was not only poor, but I was poor and wanted to be a big shot.
Sure.
So I would I would steal to have live in large Christmas presents.
You were Leo Gorsi Jr. from the Bowery Boys.
Yeah.
That's how I envisioned you walking side by side with the arms. Hey, Louie, make me a malt. Whoop-de-doo. Yeah, that's Bobby Slayton as Satch.
I love that, you know, that album.
Sure.
Goodbye Yellow Brick Road.
Oh my.
But then again, as he gained popularity and he was on the Cher show and
That's pretty much where it ended for you. As soon as he's on the
He started to get like
on the Cher show, we're punching up.
It started to get like a little too Liberace, Vegas-y.
Yeah.
But in the beginning,
there was a turning point where he, not too dissimilar from Marlon, said, "Fuck it."
The first person I emulated was Groucho Marx.
Perfect.
That was, again, there are photos, did not make the book, of single mom in the 70s, you know, the 70s outfit.
Sure.
Brother who's a jock, another brother who's a jock, and really unattractive girl wearing tails that, like, I bought from a thrift store, looking, I guess she thinks, like Groucho Marx.
How old are you in that?
Oh, this is like...
Seven?
No, yeah, probably like 10, you know, okay. 8, 9, 10.
So you had to find... tails from a thrift shop that were worn by a jockey? Or were these giant tails?
Oh no, the giant, like a grown-up.
Sure.
Yeah.
Tails that touch the ground.
Yeah, grown-up person's tails with a tie.
Come on, how did that not make the book?
I don't know.
Because there's 400 folks.
Well, I mean, that made the book, so yes. I guess once he saw that.
Well, that's the greatest. Honestly, you so chose wisely, or the editor.
My editor.
Yeah, that's
Colin.
And also to include the elegant you as well in the book cover.
It's
a great choice.
That was all
the whole damn package is perfect. I'm just going to say it.
Oh, well, thank you.
I arrived just in time to do the live ad reads. I want to thank Sweet Sam Levine. The joke was I was going to, well, not a joke, it's lame, but seamlessly join the conversation
And then I realized 3 minutes in, you're an idiot. You have to thank Sam.
No.
And Illeana for starting on time.
Yeah, their version of seamlessly transitioning was putting the camera on me and not telling me, so it's just me like...
Way to go, J-Mac, you
the
jerk.
The camera was dead.
We had camera problems working against us.
Oh, Ileana's camera went out.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Is it back working, I hope?
Yes, it is.
There's good news. 7+ years of doing this show, our mantra originally and continues,
wow.
We're not ready. would you mind a respite while I read a couple of ad reads?
Sure.
Would you like some more or any water? Or, I mean, this will take a minute 0.5, but
no,
I'll
continue to sit.
Again, thank you, Sam.
Sure.
And Jamie.
The pleasure was mine.
And Illeana for
thank
starting
you.
On
she's
time.
A delight.
Thank you.
And then some. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, so I do want to thank our sponsors today, Casper Mattresses, who, after last night's, maybe I shouldn't tip it. I was at the Clinton Foundation charity poker tournament. I'm sure that was maybe mentioned, maybe not.
No.
Under strict instructions. And the gentleman across from me was, well, Casper may or may not be patching me up for the World Series of Poker main event. I'll talk more about that next week, I suppose. Casper is a sleep brand that created one perfect mattress sold directly to customers. Have you heard about this Netflix for mattresses that Casper.com is? It's, I'm asking you, actually.
No, I have not.
It's kind of bizarre how quickly this has caught fire.
Hmm.
It is an insanely fast-growing company that people are a little nutty about. Mattresses can often cost well over $1,500 if you've ever spent time going through a mattress store and rolling around from one bed to the other for about 30 seconds. That's the other annoying part. Will this be fine for the next 10 years? Because I'm only on it for a minute.
I know.
One of the great things I love about this is there's a 100 nights risk-free in your home.
Ooh.
If you don't love it, they'll pick it up and refund you everything.
Wow.
Yeah, I think that may be one of the driving forces, along with the ridiculous comfort of their mattresses. So here you've got mattresses that cost $500 for a twin, $600 for twin XL, because that's a thing, $750 for a full, $850 for a queen, $950 for a king, and again, 100 nights risk-free. Time magazine named it the best invention of 2015. That's kind of a big deal. The single greatest invention of 2015.
Yeah.
I'm not even going to say it was a slow year.
No.
Four inventions. I'm not going to say that, technically. They'd like to offer our listeners and viewers $50 towards any mattress purchase by visiting Casper.com/Kevin using the offer code Kevin. Terms and conditions, of course, apply. Please do yourself a solid. Stop wasting your time going to mattress stores and thinking you're going to choose wisely, leaving with maybe a 30-day out at best. This is 100 nights risk-free. They deliver it to your home. You choose it online. You make your selections. It shows up at your home. And you sleep on it for a third of a year, give or take.
Amazing.
And then you say, you know what? No. It's night 99. Take this damn mattress back. And they say, on our way. So check out Casper.com. Very exciting. I also want to thank, where are the other jerks? And by jerks, I mean loving supporters of this show. Oh, yeah. Have you tried the Blue Apron, by the way?
No.
Did you,
yet another?
Yet another.
Thing I don't know? What?
Well, I'm so glad you're here.
Okay. Tell me everything.
They send these homes for like $10 on average or less per meal. Blue Apron delivers seasonal recipes along with pre-portioned ingredients to make delicious home-cooked meals. So you like to cook, not so much on the shopping, and you want to pay a lot less for exceptional ingredients. Mm-hmm. Blue Apron is your call.
Okay.
And they also kind of challenge you to cook a little better, but easily doable. Whether it's Japanese ramen noodles, wild caught Alaskan salmon. Now, do you suppose that means you're in a wild mood when you catch the Atlantic salmon?
No.
Wild caught. Or the salmon themselves are feeling a bit wild. Gotcha. Or heirloom tomatoes, Blue Apron is bringing you the best. Meals available in July. Listen up, y'all. Creamy shrimp fettuccine with sautéed green beans and spinach. Sweet chili chicken with Tinkerbell peppers. That's Tinkerbell peppers. Green beans and jasmine rice. I once had a massage. Never mind. Jasmine rice. spiced steak and tomato avocado salad with creamy cone cabbage and red onion slaw.
Cone cabbage?
Cone cabbage. That's a new one by me, creamy cone
sure
cabbage.
That's Mexican.
On your way out, try the creamy cone cabbage. Here at the ballpark, it's creamy cone cabbage night. Be sure to pick up your dose. So check out blueapron.com/chat. You will love how it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron. So don't wait. Check out this week's menu. Get your first three meals free and free shipping by going to blueapron.com/chat, C-H-A-T. I want to thank Blue Apron once again for sponsoring our efforts here. So there was the Elton John period. Mm. Did we get to the actual conversation you had with Dennis Hopper?
Yes.
When you finally met him, were able to share.
When I finally met him, and I said, this is going to be great.
In some way, all of us that grew up in that era are all children of Dennis Hopper. You were quoted as saying.
And yes.
So did you share the moment in which you had that conversation with him?
I did. Sam? And if you want, I can expound upon it.
Oh no, again, I know the story. I just want to make sure the listeners and viewers have a shot at it.
Yes.
Now, in 69. Mm-hmm. Is when the change occurs. But August of 69, mm-hmm. the word hippies gets a serious bad mark after the Manson murders.
Yes.
Those dirty hippies went a little cuckoo.
Yes.
Just prior to that, growing up a 50-minute drive south of San Francisco, mm-hmm. Dad loads up the 67 Volkswagen Bug. Our family afford a drive to San Francisco for the sole purpose to drive down Haight-Ashbury to look at the hippies. Yeah. So it's a car, imagine all cars, bumper to bumper. I say bumper to bumper because I know because the Rolls Royce, which I had not seen one prior, behind us kept tapping the little bug to the point where my dear sweet Jewish father might have lost his mind being tapped by the, I guess, what would have been a millionaire.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't a cool hippie Rolls Royce like John Lennon eventually drove. It was sparkling and it kept tapping the little bug.
Oh.
Yeah, it was very odd. But it was because everybody was gawking out the windows looking at the hippies.
Yeah.
So there they were rolled up on the 6 or 7 acre spread.
Well, no,
that the family had.
Well, what's
the
funny,
whole family, the whole spread.
What's interesting about the commune is that it was basically my father's commune.
Mm-hmm.
It was his.
Let's be clear.
It's like, you know, Peter Pan wants a commune.
That's,
you know, like
yeah.
Peter Pan suddenly decides, you know what's missing in my life, being married with three kids and going to a 9-to-5 job and having a Buick Skylark. I need my own commune.
Yep.
I need to hang around college students and start a band called 40 Acres and a Mule.
Oh my.
And I need, you know.
Oh my.
Yeah. And that's what I need. So that all happened with the first hippie, who's, you know, Tom the hippie.
Uh-huh.
And there was no, I mean, that's why.
The first one was Tom.
First one was Tom. And then they breed like rabbits.
Sure,
you know,
they do.
Tom brought Annette, and Annette brought.
Once the word spreads.
Well, that's the thing. As a kid, at first it was like, this is fun. All these, you know.
It's a people circus.
I mean, you know, like when you're a kid, it's the days of you at the top of the stairs. And
oh, yeah.
You go halfway down the stairs,
yeah.
And you're like, I'm going to mingle now with the grown-ups.
Absolutely.
Until I get thrown out.
Right.
You know. But so at first it was like, people were showing up with fringe jackets, and they told funny stories, and they played music, and, you know, they wore cool ponchos. And
I had cousins that were about 7, 8 years older, so they were of the right age to be hippies in 67, 68, 69, and they had those friends.
Yeah.
So I got them in the house. I can't imagine them roaming on the property and, in fact, living there.
Yeah, they all lived at the commune, and
fascinating.
And so we, in the, you know, in the big house, in my mom's house.
So far we've got 40 acres and a mule and the big house. For those of you keeping score.
Well, once, you know, once we would come home, and my mom, again, like, my mom's really the comic figure in all of this, because it was just like,
We're doing this now.
Like, this is what's happening.
Yep.
And, you know, but we would come home, and each day we'd come home, there were more and more people living in our house.
Eventually reaching the number of...
Oh, we came home, the memory for me was coming home from Stop and Shop.
Sure.
And there were cars and psychedelic buses, like, all the way down the driveway, and she couldn't find my brother.
Not quite the ending of Fields of Dreams, where it's... Yeah. Car lights as far as the eye can see, but that's how I'm picturing it.
Yeah.
Seems a little less organized than that.
Cars everywhere and people listening to, you know, Born to be Wild and singing That's What It's All About, Man, and stomping. And it was like, all right, that's it. You got to build your own commune.
And so that August, did the shift reach this commune? Did the word spread?
Well, I don't know, because again,
you were too young,
I was a child, and like I said, it came from a memory of, like, this is what we're going to do.
Yep.
I'm going to leave my job. We're going to start a commune. We're going to live off the land.
Right.
It's going to be amazing.
Sure.
To... Oh, who's Tom? Who's the guy on the hip? You know, who's the guy on the chopper? He's kind of fun. You know, it was fun. It was like a series of uncles,
right?
Father figures.
Sure.
That,
no, but they were all swinging, and the music was amazing, and it was a whole
fun,
world.
And they ride you on your, you know, and they would ride you. Like I said, it was in the beginning. It was fun. You know, this guy Tom had this, you know, van. Everybody had like a. It was like. Kind of a Dodge, I don't know, 50s van. Like, they would have vintage cars.
Sure.
And paint them a crazy color, but there was no seats in it, so he put stumps in the back for us to sit on. But every time...
I'm sorry, it sounded like you said he took some tree stumps.
Yeah, tree stumps.
From your and various yards.
Yeah.
And put them inside of his van.
Yeah, so, which
and
was...
for rides.
Which was great, except that, you know, the music would get going, and he'd turn a sharp corner, and all the stumps would fall. And
yeah, well, yes, they would.
Yeah, and we'd be ow, you know, like
Tom hadn't
the stumps
really
rolling over you,
and right.
But again, I remember, you know, Tom had a girlfriend, and she was adorable and really cute, and then she brings Jane, and the Jane brings Michael, and you know, before you know it, there's people living down there. And you know, and then my father would come up to the house, because like there'd be a crabs outbreak, or you know, all these things that as a kid I'm like, what are,
yeah, we're having crabs for dinner,
you know, what are, yeah, like not knowing.
So
dad
was living down there.
Yeah,
yeah,
he's at the commune,
so he would come up to the main house, the
yeah,
big house,
yes, to wash and get rid of crabs.
Sure.
Or
and spread it around there. Hey, kids.
But it was all like, again, it was all fun and exciting.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the beginning, like my mom said, they put up a chicken coop, and they had champagne. It was a big party. And then what I talk about is the progression of, like, now when you're 12 and they're like, no, we can't afford, you can't be in band. We're poor now. We can't have the thermostat above 58. Do you want peanut butter or jelly? You know, like,
yeah,
that,
the two together is out of the question.
Yeah. So they progressed to that point. Like, nobody saw that part coming. The whole free love experiment was really expensive.
Whoa. So no exit strategy, I'm assuming.
No, just started to get more and more people and crazier
until,
and more police coming. Until one day my dad just left. You know,
this is all running well.
Yeah,
I'm gonna go ahead and
that was great. You know, it's a few years, and there were still hippies. There was Scott, the last remaining hippie.
Scott.
Yeah, even after the.
It's always Scott.
This sounds like a hippie name. I gotta be honest.
By the way, Scott, still there.
Yeah, he's
I got a memo earlier from the front office that said he was still there.
Well, some of the fun parts about writing a book is how people contact you on Facebook. Even though I didn't put any names, because fear, I didn't want to be sued or anything. But somebody read it and they said, "Oh, my mom was The one who sold your dad the ambulance that they used to ride the goats around in.
I'm sorry. Let's spend a moment with all of that sentence.
Yeah, yeah.
Sold your dad an ambulance that we used to ride the goats around in.
Yes, and I was sitting there with, like, you know, you're at a book thing and you're like, oh, hi, I'm so, hi, yeah, nice to meet you. He goes, incidentally, my mom.
Right
away, where did she get the ambulance? But anyway, and that's the ambulance that they painted and they had a flag on it.
Well,
and,
sure.
Because they had a band.
Come on. What else are you going to do with an ambulance?
Well, and so when they weren't with the band, my father put the, you know, again, old cars in those days, nobody had a back seat. Or they would always take the back seat out. And so that would be part of the commune. And then everyone's back seat, as I recall, had plywood in it.
Oh, my God.
And so, you know, and they would ride the goats around in that.
So give me a little bit more of the book tour, because this started, what, a couple of months ago?
It came out in, the book came out in November. And so it's been amazing that it hasn't subsided.
Yeah.
I've been going around the country doing book readings and talking to people and telling stories, because so much of the book is, it's not only, we get to talk about the love of movies, the love of working with some of these people,
right,
and then all the fun people too that are like, yeah, my life was ruined by that movie too, you know?
Yeah.
There's a lot. Sadly, you know, because Dennis Hopper is no longer with us, one of the things I was talking to him about shortly before he passed was to do a documentary, because I said, I'm sure there's people throughout this country who, you know, you ruined a lot of people's lives with that movie. And
yes,
it's, you know, when you think of the Albert Brooks movie, Lost in America,
yes,
it's really a touchstone.
Yes.
And I think that would have been a kind of a fun idea. I mean, to me, the ultimate is to have my father meet Dennis Hopper and then somehow they implode.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and also, what better topic as someone is slowly slipping into death than... We should do a documentary, Dennis, about all the lives you ruined. Just a second, nurse. I'm curious about some of those moments along the book tour.
Yeah.
That, because it is a whole new world.
Yes.
From your wildly diverse career.
Yes.
To step into.
Mm-hmm.
I did a little tiny bit of it, and I was amazed by how different it is. Because we've been storytellers our whole lives.
Yeah.
And it takes everything to put that into a book and somehow be entertaining and captivating. And then to meet with the people who very much want to share,
mm-hmm,
as you're signing the book. And there's a line and you've only got so much time with each person.
I know.
And you don't want to be rude.
Yes.
So usually there's a person standing there,
yeah,
to help move them along.
Yes.
Any particular of those moments that might have...
I mean, so many of them, going back to, my favorite moment was going back to the Mark Twain house in Hartford, and I had left when I moved out of the, because there's a whole story about me getting my first finally professional job,
yeah,
at the Hartford Stage Company,
yeah,
again, randomly by seeing an ad in the newspaper for inner city children from high risk backgrounds.
You thought, perfect.
Who live in Hartford, and I just thought, I gotta get in this group. So I found a family that I could use their address.
And how did you find that family?
They were like friends of our, you know, my parents knew them.
I pictured the little girl knocking on doors.
Oh, well, no, I did that too. Everybody talks about that's another town. Because,
yeah,
I would steal eggs from the commune and then go on my horse and go around and sell, you know. And the people thought it was adorable, you know, to have the little hippie thing. And I did that because I was starving. But because I had to steal the eggs from,
yeah,
my parents, because I would have been in a lot of trouble.
Sure.
But everyone has these, oh, you were adorable on your little egg route. I was like, yeah, lady, I was starving, actually. But anyway, I found this family that I could use their address.
Right.
And you know, when you're young, you're like, I gotta get ahead. You know, you just don't think of any consequences.
Nope.
You just, I gotta do this. I gotta,
right,
somehow, this being in this group, it's gonna change my life. And I used their address. I got in the group, which was amazing, and I tell this whole crazy story. The basically it was like this close, and by doing a marginally good impression of Liza Minnelli, I managed to kind of scrape by. Also the fact that I was white and it was predominantly African American, and I think they needed like four white people just to kind of say that it was even. So I got in because I got in because of that, but I made good once I was in the group. But once I was in the group, big problem, I actually did not live in Hartford. So once again, I went to the newspaper, and like a movie, because I've done my whole life, has just been like, well, what do they do in the movie? In the movie, they find an ad and they rent a room in a place. In an apartment.
You knew to do that, having seen something similar in a movie.
That's what drifters or single women did in films. Yeah. So it's like a room for rent, you know?
Sure.
So I went and I lived in a room with these two crazy college guys who were heavy duty partiers. And I lived in the room while being in this stage company. And it was crazy because the kids were like, why do you have your own apartment when you're 15? So we would all come over to my place and like live large and do musical comedy. And meanwhile, in the other room, there'd be women and drugs and all sorts of crazy going on. Anyway, it's so long. But while I was in Hartford, I was telling this story. And of course, in the back, a guy waves and I go,
oh no.
Are you going to tell me you're, you know, I won't say the guy's name, on, you know, but I said, you're going to tell me you're, and it, sure enough, he was, and I said, come up here and we hug.
One of the roommates?
Yeah. Oh, and I said, why did you rent a room to a 15-year-old girl? And he's like, well, we put the ad in, you know.
Whoever was going to pay.
He said, he was like, they had interviewed people and everybody seemed like they didn't have a job and that they were maybe a drug addict.
Because you had a job.
I did have a job.
Yeah.
I was going to get paid.
Yeah.
I guess I, you know. But I said, I think I came with my mother to the...
And he was how old?
At this point?
No, at the time when you were 15. He couldn't have been more than 19, 20.
Well, he was in his 20s. He filled in the gaps for me that day, much to the enjoyment...
Of the audience.
Yeah. That he had dropped out of college.
I'll
His father had given him a lot of money, but he sort of just did, it wasn't for him, and he wanted to party and meet girls, and so he just got this apartment, and they had a really good time, you know, while I was there. And I had a room off the next to the kitchen, and you couldn't go in the kitchen at night because it was cockroaches. You couldn't like turn on the lights. It was bad. It was really, they'd go.
I just see the light coming on. Nine of them are playing poker and they look up from their cards.
It was not a clean place.
No.
It had a fire escape in the back, and you'd go. It was so hot, of course. You know, you'd no central air. But again, like, in my
you're
mind.
You're 15 and you're away 15, from the commune at that point.
Yeah,
I think
Scott was left at the commune at this point. But getting in that group did, in fact, change my life, and it was incredible. It set me up for life, because I was in that group for 3 years, and everything I learned about theater, and I got my equity card, and was ready to hit New York after being there. But on some of the book trips, you meet actual people that you've written about, and that's really touching. And again, so many people that I've written about that have, you know, thanked me or gotten emotional, or, you know, that's always the sweetest thing. Like the, you know, Richard Dreyfuss or James Woods, or, you know, that's, because it's, I still can't believe I've even, you know, I've worn them down until they basically become my friend.
Yeah, what was it like when you first told Richard Dreyfuss that there was a time in your life when you just wanted to be Richard Dreyfuss?
Well, that took years.
Yeah.
That took years. Because... as I write about in the book, my first experience was being cast in a movie, and I should not have been in this movie, Meyer Lansky.
Oh my. After being 15 and moving in with the 20-year-olds.
Yeah.
I think Meyer.
Well, I was ill-suited for the part, but John McNaughton, the lovely director, insisted that I would be great in the film, but I had to learn a Yiddish accent, and I'm not Jewish. I'm actually Italian Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
But people think like, oh, it's the same. You'll be Yiddish. And so cut to
the same.
Cut to being on the set, And John McNaughton took me aside and he's like, you sound like Barbra Streisand in The Way We Were. And I'm like, I know, that's my Yiddish. I told you, yeah. I'm funny and I have a funny cadence and this is not, I can't. I'm like, so I'm doing things like, Maya, what? You know, and it's like, it's horrible. I was so, it's so, you know, when you start as an actor, you're so earnest.
That's right.
I mean, I, you know, my teacher was Sanford Meisner, and I actually contemplated, and I seriously, like being so bad that I should just kill myself. You know what I mean? Like you're so, like, cause you can't act, cause you did badly in a scene on Friday. You'd go home and you'd be like,
well, that's it.
I shouldn't be walking and living. You know, I'm the bad actor. That's how serious I was. And then there's that moment where you're in movies, and I had been in movies. I'd skated by and done really well, and then suddenly I'm like, this is it. This is that moment. I suck. And they're filming it.
Oh, God.
And it's Richard Dreyfuss, my childhood idol. And I'm sitting there doing a scene with him, and I'm just like, I'm like, oh, God, it's like one of those people, like, I can't talk. Make words, you know, like I was trying to cry.
Sure.
I could not cry. I was like, oh my God, I can't cry. I'm just looking at him and Dreyfuss is talking to me. And it's just this bizarre, like my whole life has led up to me meeting Richard Dreyfuss and now I'm in a scene with him.
And he thinks I'm horrible.
And I suck. And he's telling me how he's gonna do the scene. He's like, I'm gonna go over to the drawer and I want you to give me a big cry and he goes, I'm going to open the drawer, and then I'm going to turn around, and I'm going to go, Anna, please. And he goes, that's where I want you to give me a big cry.
That's why he's saying Anna, please.
And then I go, oh, like that. And he goes, and then I'm going to slam the door, and I'm going to go, Anna, please, please. So, like, so he's, and I was just, like, in this, like, rote of, like, I'm horrible. I can't do a Yiddish accent. We're about to film this. But in the midst of that, as he's telling me, all I'm thinking is, I don't like the panties on the thing.
Yeah.
He's saying, I'm gonna go over the thing, and I'm gonna open the door, and I'm gonna slam the door, and then I'm gonna do that. And he's doing all of his mannerisms, and I just start to laugh.
Oh no.
I just start to laugh.
Laugh when you're supposed to be crying.
Yes,
yeah,
and
sure.
I actually, by hand to God, you can see it in the movie, because there was no alternative. I just did one of these. Because there was nothing else. I literally was like I was in acting school. I got nothing. I can't cry. It's Richard Dreyfuss, I suck. I'm just gonna cover my hands and go and see if anybody notices. And certainly John McNaughton comes in and he's like,
what are you doing?
Illeana, is there a problem? Because it looks on the monitor like you're laughing. And I go, I am laughing. You seen the man pack? He packs funny. The man packs funny. He won an Oscar. Packing funny. This is not, I'm like not good in this film,
oh
you know?
Oh my God.
But anyway, cut to, of course, like.
Yeah.
The only reason I was in the movie was so I would eventually wear, and everybody told me, they're like, we were talking about this before. Don't look at Richard.
No.
Don't talk to him.
Right.
Don't acknowledge him. He doesn't want, you know. So
yeah.
Of course, I was like, hey, that movie, Inserts. That's a good movie. So I got a funny story about that movie. You know? My grandmother took me to the movie. So I sort of, and he did, he got a little like, oh, really? My agent. Meyer Mishkin didn't want me to do that film. I was like, yeah, I
got, you got him to engage.
So we spoke a little and we took pictures and but then over the years through
right.
the director Paul Mazursky.
Yeah.
Luckily I think he forgot I was in the film with him.
Sounds like a lot of people might have forgotten.
Yeah.
That you were in the film.
Yes. That's probably a good thing. In fact, I sat, bless her heart, I was once my stories never have an ending
uh-huh.
because it's sort of like, they keep like, okay, now you're making this up.
Right.
You know, so I'm, Richard, years later, I'm on a panel at the Savannah Film Festival, and I'm with a bunch of, you know, Brett Ratner and me, and this very famous casting woman named Carrie Fraser. Dear friend, I adore her. And I didn't see, and we're all sitting on the panel. Somebody stands up and asks a question, and they go, have you ever been horribly miscast in a movie? And I burst out laughing, and I say, oh my God, that's so funny you should say that, because yes, I was once put in this movie. I begged John McNaughton, you can't put me in this movie, and it's Meyer Lansky. And I'd say I'm horrible, and I'd do the whole thing about how horrible I am. And from down the panel, Carrie Fraser goes, I put you in that movie, Illeana. And I said, and a very good choice it was, Carrie. very good choice.
Oh my.
But anyway, Richard and I later, we became friends, and then talked about working on other projects and other readings. And then eventually through, I got him to, you know, I wanted it with Turner, I was working with Turner Classic Movies, and we got him involved in that. And again, just for my own selfishness, I said, you gotta get Richard Dreyfuss on the cruise.
Come on.
I said, Richard Dreyfuss.
It's Richard Dreyfuss. Really
big, on a big boat. Like all week long, people will say.
You don't need a bigger boat.
We do not need a bigger boat. It's gonna be great. And so since then I've interviewed him. And anyway, he's a doll.
Yeah.
I adore him.
Speaking of the famous friends.
Yes.
Sex, it looks like we may have to end with this, actually. It was given a...
Oh, how sad.
Yeah. Well,
you can get the book. And
you've
call me.
Technically been going 90 minutes, which is fantastic. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
It's a fairly new portion of the show called Famous Questions. These are not questions that were made famous.
Uh-huh.
These are questions from famous people that know you and love you and you've worked with.
Oh.
Yeah.
Love it.
So I'm going to try the mystery version of giving you the question and see if you can guess.
Okay.
I think you're going to get them both immediately, if not before I finish reading them. What was the line of dialogue that Peter Sellers keeps trying to do without cracking up in the funny outtakes at the end of Being There?
Oh, that's, you go tell Raphael. Right? That's the...
The line?
Yeah.
Yes.
He says, you go tell that Raphael, yeah, that when he is talking to the doctor.
And that question was asked by what dear friend of yours? Who would you must have shared this conversation with a time or 12. Oh, it isn't immediate.
That's not immediate.
It felt like it was a thing that the two of you shared, that I've tipped it.
You go tell that Raphael.
Funny outtakes at the end of Being There.
Well, I love the funny outtakes. God, that's a challenge just because I love the movie so much. I don't know, do I just guess?
Who could arguably be called the most uniquely interesting actor you know? Uniquely interesting.
Jeff Goldblum?
Correct, continue.
Okay.
Tall Jews for 400.
Yes! And, it's funny, I thought of him in the first, he was in my...
Yeah.
You go tell that, Raphael. And since we're doing Jeff, he and I also share an obsessive love of The Heartbreak Kid.
Wow.
We love that movie.
Yeah.
The remake, of course, right?
Yes, not the remake. Sorry, not the remake.
Isn't it astonishing? Well, every remake sucks.
The original, yeah, that's true.
Every single.
Except for Cape Fear, Kevin.
I forgot there was a first one.
I know. I love this.
And this last one, you're never going to guess who wrote this.
Okay.
How did it feel to have Judd Apatow direct you in a love scene?
The best. Now, I'm hoping that's Judd Apatow.
Yes.
Because if it wasn't,
is it kind of an odd
I'd
question?
Be in trouble.
Because there is notes in here, which maybe we'll get to as the very last question.
Yes.
A comment you made, which I found kind of wonderful, that it is a common belief, and you are a subscriber, that women directors shoot the best love scenes.
Yes, they
but
do.
But first, completely dismissing Judd's ability to direct you in a love scene. That statement.
Well, again, Gary's one of those, you know, presents. And I had a funny joke idea because I have been in so an inordinate amount of love scenes with comedians.
Wow.
Yes.
Speaking of Cape Fear, De Niro, hilarious.
De Niro, hilarious. But no, Gary Shandling, Tom Arnold, Drew Carey and I shared a sleeping bag.
We shared a bathtub.
Yes, we shared a bathtub.
No love.
Jay
but,
Moore.
Yeah.
There's been many, many comedians. And but no, it was a big deal. And I think we started with that. And I was such a huge fan, of course, of the show.
Oh my, yeah.
And of Gary. But I believe he wore a t-shirt. I believe he did the classic, maybe wearing a t-shirt. But it's also awkward, and you're trying to have, you know, you're trying to just pretend it's normal. But my wonderful memories of Judd doing that show was just that it was this whole eye-opening experience,
yeah.
of working on the scripts, and this kind of, you could make the, it wasn't just jokes, it
right.
was, we were working on, you know, Gary would bring me in and literally said to me,
tell me stories of your life.
Yeah, tell me every funny thing that ever happened to you. And so I would say, you know, I grew up on the street, and we used to go, I would go make out in a place called Beaver Meadow, and that's where everybody used to make out there. I'm like, it had nothing to do with me, you know. And so he,
yeah, you know. What had nothing to do with you? The name Beaver Meadow?
Yes, well, that's why I said, so I would say that as a kid, you know, because I'm talking to Gary Shandling, and he goes, you know, and he would like write it down, and Judd was there, and then John Stewart, who was doing some consulting.
Sure.
And they were, I was like, everybody's writing down all the stuff I'm saying, you know? And then I'd get the script, and it was all
Beaver Meadow.
It was in the script. Or there was another thing, I told him how we were so poor, we didn't have an antenna, which is true. My mother couldn't afford an antenna, or, you know, and then she finally got the antenna, but she didn't get the rotor. So in order to get...
You and your brothers holding the...
No, we'd have to climb. We had a ladder at the side of the house, and my one brother would go, more to the left, more to the right, you know. And so I missed the cultural, I missed, you know, the whole what's better, the Partridge Family or the Brady Bunch. I was always watching Cannon or Barnaby Jones.
Cannon.
And so, like,
William Conrad? Who was,
yeah,
Cannon?
William Conrad.
Sure.
Who got so fat. That was my other thing. He got so, speaking of fat, he got so enormous that as the show progressed, they gave him a partner, and so he'd go, you go ahead.
You know, well, that was the whole point of Jake and the Fat Man.
Yeah, he ultimately was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he's just, that's like when I saw Luciano Pavarotti towards the end of his life, and again, he was enormous, and it was like he came on stage, and he just waited for the applause, and he was supposed to be have something sort of a sword fight.
Yeah.
And it had been arranged that it was like, I'm going to take two steps, you fall down. You know, like, it was like, one, two. The guy fell. Because he was like, I'm not exerting myself.
The name of the bestseller, There I Said It, I Blame Dennis Hopper. Get yourself a copy immediately, you idiots. I love that you could come and share.
Thank you.
And
anytime.
Thank you both with Sam Levine for starting the show in
Please.
My absence as I rushed here from the airport. Jamie, thank you as well. Don't shrug like you did nothing. I won't have it. Brian, so far still the world's greatest intern. Kenny, what do we got up there? Ryan, don't confuse it with Brian. Thank you, Ryan. And on makeup was someone I hadn't recognized.
Oh, Sonia.
Sonia, of course. Cabrera. Is that right?
Yes.
Wonderful. Corey Levin on the Media Maven.
I don't think he wants to be called that.
No?
No.
We didn't get to Jerry Lewis.
I know.
You'll have to come back.
I will come back.
You know that movie's going to see the light of day.
We don't know. I don't know. Is it?
Yes.
Is it?
Yes.
You guys talk about The Day the Clown Cried, yeah?
Because yeah.
That too.
Portions of that have seen the light of day.
Yes.
Max Rose is the name of the film that
yes.
that we did with Jerry Lewis.
Yes.
It just had a new cut premiere
at MoMA.
MoMA.
Yes.
And went phenomenal.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's good. I'm
so
happy.
So we'll have to have you back a third time.
Yes.
You'll have to set a record.
The travels
of Jerry Lewis.
Of Jerry. Jerry and I. And you're the one who's responsible for that. Because when I was coming to the set and the director was like, "Why are you here? Your scenes are done." I'm like, "Well, Jerry asked me to come." And I said, "I asked you for advice."
Yes.
I said, "Is that weird? Should I not be coming here?" And you said, "Because I'm no longer in the film
right.
anymore. My scenes have been shot."
Yeah.
And you said, "Go for it." And so you're responsible. Yeah, basically you're responsible for
the
everything.
Book.
You're responsible for the book. Because you were writing the book.
Yeah.
You're responsible for
Well, Jerry you're welcome
Lewis.
For everything, and thank
welcome.
You.
Thank you.
Honestly and truly. I won't ask you to do the Larry King game, because we have one on record already.
Yes.
Yeah. And folks should go to the archives on the YouTube to check out Illeana's illustrious Larry King game. Mm. That is it for now. Until next time, and as always, get out of my face.